Welcome families to the On My Way to K with PBS Kids Kindergarten Readiness Series for parents and caregivers just like you. My name is Janice Santi with WUCF, your Central Florida PBS station. We are so excited that you've joined us for session 4, I Spy Math. During this session, we will discuss ways to support your child in the areas of thinking critically about math concepts, developing problem-solving skills, and communicating their mathematical ideas. If you have any questions, please be sure to contact me at the information on this screen via email, text, or even cell. We'll be more than happy to assist you with any of your questions. Great news! We have created the wucf.org/kready website with all of the session recordings, presentations, activities, and printable links. If you've missed any of the resources, please go visit our page and check out all of the information for every single session. PBS Kids shows and apps are all aligned to learning goals, and these goals support all areas of development. In other words, it supports your child, the whole child. Today, we're going to be learning about mathematical thinking, what number sense is, patterns, shapes, and measurement. And we're also going to provide you with a variety of family resources that you can use to support your blossoming kindergartner into a mathematician. Let's think about math like climbing stairs. Each step includes skills and concepts that children need to understand and master in order to build more complex skills. Let's look at the standards that address mathematical thinking and approaches to learning. Let's start with approaches to learning. Approaches to learning is a standard that really incorporates all areas of learning. It is how your child looks at learning, the how of learning, how they deal with new problems, how they interact, and how they discover. It actually creates that attitude and disposition towards the love of learning. When we look at this area a little closer, we're going to see that it includes the how I grow, which refers to the eagerness and curiosity of how children address learning, the persistence and challenges that empower them to keep learning, creativity, and planning and reflection. We'll continue to the next page, and we have the Help Me Grow section. This includes a few fun caregiver strategies you can do at home with your kids in order to help them and actually observe how they address new areas of learning and how they problem solve. The last section of this standard includes the Explore, Let's Explore Together. These are PBS Kids aligned resources that you can use to help support this standard and this area of learning with your child. Mathematical thinking is more than just numbers and counting. Math is in every daily activity that we do, in our routines, in our interactions with other people, and also in the interesting way that we build, for example, looking at shapes, recognition that the world around us is full of patterns and shapes. In the area of mathematical thinking, the how I grow are the standards, which include, of course, number sense and problem solving. And this means how numbers relate to one another, and understanding that numbers are really a combination of other numbers. We also look at patterns. We can do patterns in colors, shapes, sizes, even routines. Looking at shapes, both two-dimensional shapes and three-dimensional shapes. Spatial skills, the spaces in the surrounding, how things are, where the things are located. For example, above, below, next to. So this is relation of objects to the real world. And the last is measurement. Of course, height, weight, capacity, money, temperature, all these are considered measurement. The next section is the help me grow. So these are the caregiver strategies, little tricks and little activities that you can do to observe your child and get an understanding of their mathematical thought processes. The last one is the Let's Explore Together, which again have the alignment between PBS Kids shows and apps and this standard. So one of the greatest ways that you can support your child in math understanding is through math talk. So what does math talk mean? Well, math is the way of communicating how they understand the mathematics, what made sense in their brains, the processes that they use. And this is not an easy skill for children. Sometimes you'll hear that, oh, because my brain told me, or because I know. It doesn't really explain why they understand that concept or how they got there. So this is a skill that takes a lot of practice and a lot of questioning. Let's look at some of the questions that you can ask your child to develop math talk. Let's begin with the understanding that math is about communicating the thinking of our proof, how we justify, we can represent our thinking as well, and ways you can ask your child as they're doing mathematics and playing with shapes or creating patterns or writing numbers is, well, how did you know? What did you notice when you did that? Remember to allow them time to think. Problem solving takes a long time. And it's not about a Q&A. It's not about getting the right answer. It's about thinking through the process and understanding why you did what you did and how you came across that answer. One of the greatest things you'll find and the greatest rewards is that when you do this with your child, when you ask questions and you give them time to think, it's going to expose a lot of misconceptions and misunderstandings that they may have. This is really important because remember we talked about that stairway in math. If you have a misconception, if you build a strong idea on a misconception or misunderstanding, you're going to have difficulty with the next level that relies on what you've learned previously. And it also helps your child to connect these ideas and things that they're doing to real world experiences. We're going to take a look at a few pictures and we're going to ask some questions and I'm going to let you know about some of the common misunderstandings that children may have when they're talking about mathematical concepts. Here are some examples of mathematical misconceptions that you may have, your child may have when you're having math discussions. For example, look at the two triangles. You can ask your child, are they the same? Your child may say yes, but at the same time, they may say no, because children at this stage are really literal. So when they're looking at those two triangles, they may think, well, no, they're not the same because one's green and one's blue. But if they have an understanding of triangles, they will find out that triangles are really, the description of triangles are three corners or vertices. And yes, we do use vertices in kindergarten. And three sides. So anything that fits that definition, three corners and three sides, is a triangle, regardless of its position in space. Another concept is the middle one, logs. Please look at these logs. When we talk about which one do you think is the highest, I mean, the tallest one, the highest one, tallest. Well, many children will say the third one. It really looks tallest. But in reality, when we talk about measurement, we have to develop this understanding that all things that are measured have to start in the same common base. So if you're talking about height, they have to start at the same level so that you can compare the heights. If you're talking length, they have to start at the same point so you can determine the length of an object. Let's look at those counters. You see four counters. But when you ask your child, how many counters are there? Or how many dots do you see? They may tell you, well, they see 3 red ones and 1 yellow one. Again, that is that literal thinking again. It will take a while for children to see that whole set of 4 or vice versa. They may see 4, but they may not be able to recognize that that 4 really is 3 and 1 or a combination of both. So let's look at the 3 characters. You may ask your child, well, which character is beside or next to something? You may have your child say, oh, this character over here is beside the 5. And in our mind, that's what we think. Oh, yes, you're right. That's the one that's beside something else. Well, some children may say it's this character. So that comes to that math talk. When we look at reasoning and justification of answers, if your child can say to you, well, she is next to this green triangle, then that does justify in a way that is true. So it's best, instead of saying, no, that's not right, this other character is the one that's next to it, listen to your child, have them explain, because that way we may have misconceptions and they may have misconceptions. So it helps clear ours up as well. Here are some great resources from Sesame Street. This printable math talk, it provides math words and phrases to help you have a discussion with your child and help them develop that math knowledge. The cards in the middle are an interactive online set of cards, and I love these cards because on the back, it gives you a real-world example of how to describe or show that concept. My favorite one is inside and outside. Well, they give you an example of peel a banana with your child and talk about the inside of the banana and the outside. That's a real-world concrete example of in and out. Also, the printable for the mathematics on the go cards. Those are the same as the interactive ones online, but these also come in English and in Spanish. Number sense. What does that mean? Well, number sense is the relationship of numbers to one another and to objects. For example, when creating sets, it is the combination of, maybe in that 4 example we talked about, of a 1 and 3. That is a representation of the 4. So this relationship of numbers and understanding what that means creates that number sense. Let's look at number sense in a little more detail. Number sense refers to counting 1 to 1. An understanding that every object needs to be counted individually. And there's some strategies that we'll talk about to use 1-to-1 correspondence or 1-to-1 counting. It also means that the last number you counted represents the number of objects in that set. That's called cardinality. Recognizing that sets up to 5 without counting. For example, when you use a die, you can see the faces and understanding that dots have a pattern on them. And there is a number, there's a number set that represents each of those. And well, of course, we only go up to 5. So the next one is creating and counting sets of objects. And looking at these sets of objects, we can count using 1-to-1 correspondence, understanding that the last number we counted means that's how many it is. And then taking these 2 sets and comparing them. Which one has more? Which one has less? Which one has equal amounts? What does equal really mean? So equal is not always the answer. Equal means that whatever is on one set is the same as the other set. And those are one of those concepts that your child will go and learn through as they progress through kindergarten. Let's take a quick look at the game Peg Plus Cat's Pizza Place. In this game, your child's going to practice that one-to-one correspondence and also that cardinality of knowing that the last number they counted is the one that means how many altogether.
Mamma mia! This place is packed! We'll never be able to serve all these customers without your help. Will you help us? Pretty, pretty, please!
Oh!
Here is your list of customers, and here are the toppings we'll use. Okay, let's put some toppings on this pizza. Mora wants her pizza to have 4 pieces of tomato. Add toppings to the pizza. When you think you've added the right number of toppings, click this button here.
So let's put those on one to one. So we're actually gonna touch each object and put them on the pizza. 1, 2, but what if we stop and we tell your child, well, how many, we need 4. How many do we have there? We have 2. So we use the strategy.
Click the dot button to check if you're right.
Okay, Peg. So we use the strategy counting on. That means we know we have 2. So we now to continue. What comes after 2? Well, 3 and then 4. Now we have 4. So let's count them to double check what that means, that we have the right amount.
Perfect. Let's count to be sure. 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, let's put some toppings on this pizza. The pig wants his pizza to have 6 pieces of pepper.
As you can see, we can continue to talk about one-to-one correspondence, making sure that your child touches each object and recognizes that whatever they've counted actually means how many are in that set. When we talk about math tools for young children, there are so many very easy everyday objects that we could use for them to touch and to talk about creating sets and orders and numbers. These are called manipulatives. So let's look at a few of everyday kind of manipulatives that you can use, you can find around the house. One of the easiest manipulatives that kids have, and it helps them understand numbers, are their fingers. These are tools. Eventually, they will use fingers, and we want them to get off of using their fingers. But once they have an understanding, they automatically stop because they're developing that number sense. We can also use things like a simple die. Dominoes, those dots represent numbers. So recognition of those numbers are a great way to just understand those sets. And when you talk about counters, simple things such as beads and pom-poms, beans, pieces of cereal, go outside for a nature walk, find some sticks, those are counters, count them as you go. Rocks and pasta, leaves, anything can be a counter. And a simple way to organize numbers is with something called a 5-frame or a 10-frame. And that is actually a repetitive pattern of numbers, of sets. So 5 and then 2 sets of 5. And you'll know that the mathematical system is all based on tens. So once they understand the combinations of 5 and then they move on to understand combinations of 10, they have developed the foundation they need to build on their knowledge of the base tens that mathematics is built upon. Okay, it's game time. We're going to play a game with our fingers. And this is a great way for your child to develop that number sense and actually sort of recognize patterns really quickly. So the number the game that I'm going to play is called Numbers, Numbers, 1, 2, 3. So what you do is you put your hands either down or behind your back, and you're going to show your set of numbers really quickly and then take them away. Your child has to recognize how many you have. So I'll start with Numbers, Numbers, 1, 2, 3. How many numbers do you see? Oh, the answer is 4. How do you know there's 4? Well, I have five fingers in my hand and you had one down, so I know that that's fourth. That's a reasonable justification of how that is, as opposed to because I know. So we want to encourage that conversation. Let's try it again. Numbers, one, two, three. How many numbers do you see? Did you say 10? Well, how did you know there were 10? Well, I know I have five fingers in this hand, and I know I have five fingers in the other hand, and I know that I have 10 fingers, so I know that means 10. That's the same. We can continue that with 5 and 2. How many numbers do you see? Well, I know there's 5, and I can count on 6, 7. That's how I know. We can also play one more, one less. The same thing. How many numbers do you see? We're going to show me one less. Ready? So here I go. I'm going to show you some numbers. My fingers. Ready? Well, what did you see? You saw 5. So what's one less? And they can, I know 4. And they may have to use their fingers to figure it out. That's okay. Eventually, they'll be able to do that without the support of their fingers, but you need a lot of practice. So can you show me another way to make this number? That's another game we can play. What if I want to know how to make 4? How can I make 4 another way? Well, I know I can make 3 and I put one over here, 1, or I can say, 2 and 2, is that still 4? 1, 2, 3, 4. Your child may say no, because again, they're literal, but this takes practice. Or really, you can say that it's 4 and 0, or 0 and 4. That's still 4. So now we're going to play with the die. So let's look at the die. And one of the things that we do with the die is that we want to recognize the dot patterns. So playing a game with dice is a great way for your child to recognize that this is a 3, and I don't necessarily have to count it because I know that's 3. This is a 5, and I know that I don't have to count it. This is a 1, obviously, and this is a 2. So how do I know that this number we talked about before is a 4? Well, once repeated practice with those fingers and with counters, your child will be able to tell you in a more sophisticated way why that is 4. Well, they can say things like, well, I know that I have 2, and I know that 2 and 2 more is 4. So they start to recognize that 4 is really a set of 2 and another set of 2. That is a great way to continue to understand that number sense. Here's 6. So how do you know that 6? Well, I know that 3 and 3 is 6. So that is how I know that it's 6, because I also see 4, and then I have 2 more, 4, 5, 6, I can count on. So all of these are strategies that actually create a sense of understanding of what numbers are and the relationship to each other. Okay, so we've talked about fingers and we've talked about dice. Let's look at dot cards. So if you see the dot cards are really taking those numbers that we already are familiar with, those patterns, and sort of moving them around and identifying those groups of numbers. We're also going to take a look at how to use dominoes as a way of recognizing and developing number sense, and the 5 and 10 frame. So let's take a look at dot cards first. The dot cards on that page are printable from the National Council for Teachers of Mathematics. And let's see what those dot cards represent. So when we talked about 4 that we identified on our die, we can also arrange these dots in a different fashion and talk about math and what that understanding of numbers is. For example, if I rearrange those dots to look this way, yes, this would be the normal one, but if I arranged it like this, that's a different way for kids to see it. How do you know that's 4? Well, initially, your child may count one, two, three, four. But after they've done it a while, oh, well, because I see two and two, or I know that that's three. And then I know if I have three, one more, that's four. What if I arrange the four to look like this? Well, the same thing. It's two and two, or three and one, or I just know that that's four. I can tell visually without having to count it. And again, that's a skill that takes some practice. So how about if I do this? What is this? Well, some children who've had a lot more experience can say, well, if I move this dot in the middle to over here, it looks like this number on the die, because that would make the four. And it also, when they have a little more sophistication with the numbers, they can even say, well, it almost looks like a five. If I know if I put one more dot there, it's going to be five, but without it, that's one less, so it would be four. So you could see these dot cards is just a way of talking about numbers and developing a sense of numbers. You can use manipulatives to create those sets as well. So if you have beans, you can use those to create those sets as well, and create those sets and show that's how you know. Another tool, using dominoes. So I'm going to use that example of four again. Here's a domino. Now, when I use this domino, I can just look at one side. You don't have to talk about both sides together, because that would be like an addition example, which we can do. But for right now, we could say, well, can you find four on one side or the other side? So what your child can do is you can use the dry erase sleeve, and you can use this sheet and put that in here. So when your child is in here, we're looking for patterns of four. So on this side, you'll have the combinations that they can add and count them all together. But on the other side of the sheet, you're identifying how many on one side and how many on the other side of the domino. So if I were to use that example of four and two, I could draw four dots and I could draw two dots on the other one and then write the numbers underneath. This is really a great way for your child to practice one-to-one, to understand that that set is equal of it, me represents that number, and also even use the dot card to represent that on their domino. So simple, easy ways, but it takes time and practice to develop that number sense. Ready for some 10 frame games? So now look at the sheet playing with 10 frames. Now notice that you can take this sheet and fold it in half to make a 5 frame. So you can use it both ways until your child has developed more of a sense of 10. You can use simple counters. Here I have some magnetic chips, and I can say I can pick up any dot card. I can roll the dice. I can print two of these. You can have a five frame and I can have a 5 frame, or you can have a 10 frame and I have a 10 frame. We could roll the die and let's say, oh, I got a number one, so I have to put one on mine. You roll yours. Oh, you got a 5, so now you have to put 5 on yours. And you keep playing to see maybe who got to 10 first. So when you're doing this game, you can even talk about, well, I had 3, so I have 2 more. So now I have 3 and 2 more, 3, 4, put 2 more. Now I have 3, 4, 5. Now I have 5. So you're having that discussion of adding on and who gets to 10 first. Because who doesn't like games we could play? So the same thing you could do with dominoes. Play the domino game. So find a domino and say, okay, I'm going to lift up my domino. How many do I have? Oh, I have 2. So I'm going to put my 2 chips. Now you pick a domino. How many do you have? So obviously to play that with a 10 frame, you'll have to first sort all of the dominoes that have less than 10. So now to play the game, you have to actually do the sorting ahead of time with your child, have them help you. And you know, you never know, whoever gets that 5 and 5 chip at the end of the game, we pick it up, they're the ones that have 10. It's an automatic win. So that's a fun game to play with, using the dominoes, using chips, using dog cards. It just provides a lot of really fun and easy practice on how to create that number sense and numbers to 10. Another area of math that you're going to have fun with is patterns. So patterns are repetitive in nature. You can repeat colors, you can repeat music, you can repeat routines. Do you know your life cycle is a pattern when you're born and when you're a teenager, when you're a grown up? All that is a life pattern. The patterns of, for example, a butterfly, those are life cycles and those are patterns. How about day and night? Day and night is a pattern. When you go to bed, it's nighttime. When you wake up, it's daytime. And that continues on. So here are some fun activities and some games you could play with your child to actually develop that sense of patterns and repeating concepts and numbers. Let's look at this game from Peg plus Cat. It's called the Chicken Dance. And in this game, you'll see different ways to represent patterns.
These little chickens have a big problem. They're trying to do a really cool dance, but they keep getting stuck. Could you help them finish their chicken dance, please? Step should this last chicken do?
So look at these patterns. You have shapes. You can use it. Is it purple, red, purple?
What dance step should this last chicken do?
What comes next? You can actually go by shapes, triangle, diamond, triangle.
What dance step should this last chicken do?
I'm going, Peg. How about even the dance moves? Those have a pattern itself. So by following the pattern,
that's it! Chicken dance! Can you help the chickens do another dance?
So as you continue through that game, it gets a little more complicated. The patterns get more sophisticated, and your child has an opportunity to either follow the pattern by shape, by color, or by dance moves. Let's look at another one called Pink a Dance from Pinkalicious.
Pink a Dance. Hi there. Who's ready for some pinkatastic dancing? Oh yeah! Pink a moves. Before we start dancing, let's warm up with some stretches. Reach for your toes!
So, reaching, also up and down, is a pattern.
That was pink amazing! Twist your waist!
Also a pattern, left to right, left to right.
Nice stretching!
Circle your arms!
Round and around.
Time to dance! Let's create some pinka moves. Everyone stand up and get ready to dance! You can tap the music buttons to change the song. Tap the arrow button to get a new pinka move, or I'll give you one. Hop to the music!
So you see in that dance pattern, up and down, even hopping is an action of up and down. It is a pattern. We even have a weather tracker. So maybe you can track patterns in the weather. And also you can even get a plain calendar. This is one that we made, but you can have a plain calendar and track the days of the week. those are patterned in months. You start at the week on Sunday, end on Saturday, back to Sunday. We have patterns of weekdays and weekends. Months of the year are patterns. And special days we can identify how many days until something else happens. So now we're counting ahead and counting back. So great practice in everyday applications on how to use patterns. The next area we're going to talk about are shapes. And shapes are so fun because once kids understand that shapes are all around them, they're always going on a shape hunt. Now, we talked about before that shapes, what is sometimes tricky for kids is the orientation of the shape. If you take a triangle and you turn it a certain way, is it still a triangle? So what we try to do is to develop an understanding of what defines a shape by the sides, by the corners and vertices, and the direction of the shape. Can we move it? Can we change it to make it something that we recognize? So let's take a look at some shapes and some fun activities we can do with them. So when we talk about shapes, children are working on naming shapes, recognizing the shape amongst other shapes, so sorting them out, also creating a shape. They have to know what that shape is. Oh, I want you to make a triangle. What does the definition of a triangle mean? Now I can create it. Understanding the properties that identify a shape, as we talked about sides, corners, and vertices, and also about changing that directionality or the spatial sense of those shapes. And here's a great, easy tool that you can use to develop that sense of recognizing shapes, forming them, and talking about their properties. This tool is called a geoboard. You can find it at your local dollar store. So you'll see there are pegs on this geoboard, and on the other side, there are circle pegs. So this would be, for example, circles, half circles. We're going to look at this side. And these come with rubber bands, or you can purchase rubber bands to create this set. So let's look at a triangle. When we create a triangle, we are talking about the corners of a triangle, the vertices. We know there are three, and it has three sides. So how can we use this tool? Well, a standard way to make a triangle, we can talk about this has three sides and three corners. How can we change this shape to make a triangle a different way, but it still has to have three sides and three corners? So we can maybe change it and it can look like this. Whoops, it can look like that. That's a short one. How about a long one with a different angle on it? Is that still a triangle? Well, let's talk about what we know about triangles. They have three corners and three sides. So yes, this is a triangle. Now you'll see that your children will just love to create all different shapes, all different patterns, experiment, make things that are not the shapes that are they don't recognize, but it's still playing with vertices and sides, and it makes it easier for them to really understand what defines a shape by its sides, by its vertices, and orientation in space. Other skills that we reinforce with shapes are sorting by those characteristics we talked about, sides and vertices. And a huge concept is also constructing shapes and deconstructing shapes. That means that shapes are made up of other shapes. For example, this orange rectangle is actually two squares side by side. Once your child has a good understanding and an observation and experiences with shapes, they'll be able to recognize them in their environment much more often. So let's play some games with pattern blocks. You can make pattern blocks out of paper. You can buy pattern block shapes at your local dollar store. They're very inexpensive, a small set, but it really does help children look at those shapes that construct new shapes and deconstruct new shapes. Let's first talk about the shapes. So At initial glance, children will say, oh, that's an octagon. Why? Because they're familiar with the stop sign. But when we talk about, well, let's talk about an octagon has 8 sides and 8 vertices. Let's look at this shape. This is called a hexagon. Hexagon means that it's 6 sides and 6 vertices. So 6 sides and 6 vertices. So we can count 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Oh, so that's different. Okay. Now we can talk about another shape called the trapezoid. So the trapezoid has a long side and a short side and 2 what we call slants on the side. That defines a trapezoid. Of course, we can talk about triangles. We experimented with triangles on our geo board. This triangle, all sides are equal in this example, but I'll show you why they do that in a pattern block shortly. We can actually talk about this shape. So kids may say, oh, that's a diamond, which in respect, it is a diamond, but it's also a parallelogram. So that one side is parallel to the other and there's 2 slants, one going one direction. They're both going direction parallel to each other. And we can also define this as being a parallelogram, but it's real a diamond as well. And of course, the square. So now we can actually take all of these shapes and we can sort them. All the ones that have 4 sides and 4 vertices can go in one pile. Those all have 4 sides and 4 vertices. They're not the same, but they do have them. All those that have 6, well, there's only the hexagon. And oh, we forgot this one with 4. So the trapezoid also has 4 sides and 4 vertices. And the only one that has 3 is the triangle. So now let's talk about composing shapes and decomposing shapes. So here we have a shape, but I want to compose the shape. I want to make the shape and replicate it with other pattern blocks. So I can, the more your child has experiences and opportunities, the more they understand about shapes. So I can look at this and I can see that if I put that on top, that really a hexagon is really a trapezoid, half of a trapezoid. But if I add another trapezoid on top, now I have 2 trapezoids together, make a hexagon. That's pretty interesting. So let me look at the hexagon. I can see that if I put on this hexagon, if I put a triangle on this side, oh, I wonder how many triangles will fit on this trapezoid. Well, what if I put, I see one on one end and I can put one on the other end like this. Oh, wait a minute. Now I see I can put 3 because look, there's a little triangle area in the middle. So I can put 2 there. And then I can make the 3rd one. So now I can actually have 3. I can discover that there are 3 triangles to make this trapezoid. Oops, there it goes, 3. So if it takes 3 to make this trapezoid and there are 2 trapezoids on this hexagon, how can I put the triangles on the hexagon to figure out how many it would take to create a hexagon out of triangles? So that's an experimentation that your children can do. Also, you can talk about, well, I see this shape, this trapezoid, but look at this parallelogram. What if I put this here? Whoa, look what happened. If I put it on top of there, I see that I can add a triangle here. So that's called composing shapes. So making new shapes out of existing shapes. And decomposing would be to take a shape and take it apart and understand there are 2 different shapes to make one. Composing to put them together and make a new shape. Decomposing to take them apart and find the shapes that create that one shape. So you can even use regular simple cards and create a design with your shapes. For example, you can use this to say if you wanted to put all these squares all the way around, what would it look like? Can I fill in? Are there any areas I can fill in? I can play with this and keep figuring out, oh, look, I can do, can I get another shape to fit in there, and create different designs for those patterns, and sort of recognize and understand that what I can create based on the size and the vertices of each. Now let's talk about measurement. Measurement, there are two different units that we use in measurement. We use standard units. Those are that are recognized globally as a standard. We know gallons. We can say that we know a cups or a certain number of ounces, temperature, whether it's Fahrenheit or Celsius. But there's also a non-standard units of measurement. And that's what kids are using. We can measure how long something is using paper clips, how tall something is by stacking a cup on top of the other, or just using a balance to figure out which one, what weighs more, what weighs less. So let's play a game, a measurement game from Sesame Street. It's called Measure That Foot.
This monster needs a new shoe that fits. First, let's measure the monster's foot. Great block ruler! This monster's foot is 3 blocks long. Click on your block ruler and put it under each shoe. When you've measured the shoe that's the same length as your ruler, click on it. Great measuring! The shoe fits perfectly. You use the blocks to measure and find the monster a shoe that fits. That's one happy monster.
Now, you'll see when measuring, one of the things that we can do when we practice measuring with kids is that we can predict. We can predict how long something is and then measure it, and then check our prediction. Look at all these ways to use measurement every day. When you go to the grocery store, you can talk about how things are organized and sorted, the size of objects you picked, how much they weigh. You could use their scale in the produce department. How fun. You can even talk about things that are the temperature of things. Well, there's things in the frozen area. There's things that don't need to be refrigerated. Even when you cook, you could talk about the sequence of steps that you make things. You could talk about the temperature and how long it takes and how much of the ingredients. When you do laundry, you can sort and talk about, do you want to need hot water or cold water? How much detergent do you use? The quantity, how long it takes to cycle? And bath time, do you like warm water? You don't want hot water. Oh, and cold water, oh, I don't know. So let's make some warm water. You can talk about the shape and sizes of your bath toys, how much water is in the tub, and also play sink and float. Those are just great ways to explore measuring in everyday activities. You'll also find some games here and some videos that you can explore with your child on ways to use measurement. So I'm gonna show you a really fun video from Snack Hacks, something we created, and now we're going to make banana butterflies. So let's talk about measurement in this recipe.
On this Snack Hacks, we're making banana butterflies. First, slice your banana into halves. Next, make wings out of pretzels. Then, break a pretzel stick for each antenna. Add raisins for eyes. Last, cut a strawberry to make a mouth. Good job! You've made banana butterflies! For more Snack Hacks recipes, go to wucftv.org/snackhacks.
That was sort of fun. Don't you want to make some banana butterflies? You could talk about breaking those pretzels in half and cutting your banana in half using all that math terminology to create a fun snack with your child. So here are some family resources that you can use for some everyday math fun. Here is a bunch of collections on PBS Kids, PBS Learning Media, and PBS for Parents on ways to use math every day. You know, you can find PBS in a variety of locations, including YouTube, through the PBS Kids app, the PBS Kids games, and now for homework, because we've learned so much about math, we have to actually put it into practice. So for homework for this session, I would love for you to play some domino games with your kids. Sort all the ones that have equal to 8, or maybe all the ones that have a 3. Talk about, or maybe sort the ones that have more, pick a number and sort the ones that have more than that number and less than that number, and talk about that math talk. Use that math talk. Also, you can check out PBS Kids for Parents. This link leads you to a collection of recipes. So find a recipe that's interesting for you and your child, or maybe just it's easy and fun to do, and explore and have some time together talking about math and measuring. And then put your spy glasses on, go outside and look for shapes all around you. Don't forget to either take a picture of a shape you find or take your geoboard with you. And then recreate that shape and talk about it and show others what you found. Make sure you check out all of our family resources from our partners as well and our WUCF site. And if you have any questions, feel free to reach out and I will be more than happy to answer any questions or any resources that you're looking for your child in any area of development. Families, thank you for watching today and keep doing math with your child. On behalf of WCF, your Central Florida PBS station, and PBS Kids, we thank you and enjoy learning together.